Are you familiar with General Soleimani?
Yes. Go ahead. Give me a little. Go ahead. Tell me.
He runs the Quds forces.
Yes. Okay. Right.
Do you expect his behavior?
I think the Kurds, by the way, have been horribly mistreated by us.
The Quds forces, the Iranian Revolutionary Guards Quds forces, the bad guys.
Right.
Do you expect his behavior to change as a result?
Kurds.
No. Kurds.
Oh, sorry. I thought you said Kurds. Because I think the Kurds have been very poorly treated by us. Go ahead.
Agreed. So Soleimani runs the Quds forces. Do you expect his behavior is going to change as a result of this deal with Iran?
I think that Iran right now is in the driver's seat to do whatever they want to do. I think what's happening with Iran is, I think it's one of the, and I covered it very well, I assume you saw the news conference. I think Iran is, it's one of the great deals ever made for them. I think it's one of the most incompetent contracts I've ever seen. I'm not just talking about defense. I'm not talking about a contract with another country. I've never seen more of a one-sided deal, I think, in my life. Absolutely.
Well, Soleimani is to terrorism sort of what Trump is to real estate. He's many people would say he's the most dangerous man in the world, and he runs the Quds forces, which is their Navy SEAL. Do you think they're going to stop?
The gentleman that was going back and forth with Russia and meeting with Putin, I read something, and that seems to be also where he's at.
On the front of Islamist terrorism, I'm looking for the next commander-in-chief to know who Hassan Nasrallah is, and Zawahiri, and al-Julani, and al-Baghdadi. Do you know the players without a scorecard yet, Donald Trump?
No, you know, I'll tell you honestly, I think by the time we get to office, they'll all be changed. They'll be all gone. I knew you were going to ask me things like this, and there's no reason because, number one, I will hopefully find General Douglas MacArthur in the pack. I will find whoever it is that I'll find. But they're all changing you. You know, those are like history questions. Do you know this one? Do you know that one?
I don't believe in gotcha questions. I'm not trying to, you know, quiz you on who the worst guy in the world is.
Well, that is a gotcha question, though. I mean, you know, when you're asking me about who, you know, who's running this, that is not, I will be so good at the military, your head will spin.
I'm honestly surprised Trump didn't just pretend he thought Hugh Hewitt was talking about the Chicago Cubs and how many people are saying that this is going to be their year. This is an interview from Hewitt's syndicated radio show in 2015, wherein Trump puts on full display the extent to which he is utterly and completely unqualified for the job he now holds. Aside from the unacceptability of a candidate to be president of the United States having no idea how to distinguish an Iranian military unit and a Middle Eastern ethnic group, it's his BS way of trying to cover for himself that puts on full display just how shamelessly he'll lie to try and protect himself. For example, he pretends that he misheard Hewitt and thought that he was talking about the Kurds when he said Quds forces, only to later complain that being asked a question about proper nouns was basically a gotcha question and totally unfair. So, which is it? Did Trump totally know what the Quds forces were and simply mishear the words? Or did he not know because such a question is a gotcha question and isn't fair? Because, and I know you're not going to believe this, but it's almost like he's speaking out of both sides of his mouth. By the way, you gotta love the irony here in basically the only reasonable thing that Trump said during this entire segment, which is that the Kurds are being treated poorly, when only 3 years later, Trump would completely abandon the Kurds and leave them for dead at the hands of the Turks while they were guarding ISIS prisoners during another one of his brilliant military decisions. And look, I'm not saying you need to have military experience to serve as commander-in-chief, but maybe, just maybe, Trump's resume, which consists solely of lying about bone spurs to avoid military service, isn't the best qualification to lead the most powerful military in the world. And you'd think after the first time that Trump fumbled a question about international affairs that he'd seek advice from someone with even a modicum of qualification whose last name isn't Trump or Kushner and whose resume doesn't include making handbags or losing millions of dollars in real estate deals. But not only did he fail to do so, he actually bragged about the fact that he relies on himself as his own advisor.
So Donald, you have been pretty confident that you can do this from the get-go. I think people now are realizing you are on a path to the nomination. Who are you talking to consistently since we have some dire foreign policy issues percolating around the world right now? Who are you consulting with consistently so that you're ready on day one?
I'm speaking with myself, number one, because I have a very good brain and I've said a lot of things. In fact, in my book in 2000, I talked about Osama bin Laden, and I do remember somebody putting the book in front of Joe and Joe saying no way he talked about it, no way he wrote about Osama bin Laden before the World Trade Center came down. And they said, no, he really did. And I remember Joe looking at it in the book saying, I don't believe it. That's amazing. Okay. So I know what I'm doing. And I listen to a lot of people. I talk to a lot of people. And at the appropriate time, I'll tell you who the people are. But I speak to a lot of people.
How would you...
My primary consultant is myself. And I have, you know, I have a good instinct for this.
Of course, since he's actually become president, it hasn't gotten any better. In the official press release from the White House, the organization in which Soleimani was a general was incorrectly identified as the Iranian Revolutionary Guard Corps, as opposed to the correct organization, the Islamic Revolutionary Guard Corps. The legality of the strike was called into question, considering launching a strike without congressional approval requires the presence of an imminent threat, which the White House has refused thus far to identify. And in fact, a correspondent to the New York Times who spoke with intelligence officials claimed that evidence suggesting an imminent attack on American targets by Iran to be, quote, razor thin. But oh, it gets worse. Trump then took to Twitter on Saturday evening and threatened Iran against retaliation, writing, Iran is talking very boldly about targeting certain USA assets as revenge for our ridding the world of their terrorist leader who had just killed an American and badly wounded many others, not to mention all of the people he had killed over his lifetime. Let this serve as a warning that if Iran strikes any Americans or American assets, we have targeted 52 Iranian sites, representing the 52 American hostages taken by Iran many years ago, some at a very high level and importance to Iran and the Iranian culture, and those targets and Iran itself will be hit very fast and very hard. The USA wants no more threats. Only, I guess another side effect of being your own consultant is broadcasting to 68 million Twitter followers the threat to commit war crimes. As the Geneva Convention and the Department of Defense considers making the clearly recognized historic monuments, works of art, or places of worship which constitute the cultural or spiritual heritage of peoples the object of attack, a war crime. And all of this makes it all the more absurd that Trump was actually pointing to himself being a political outsider as some kind of a positive. It's not. And now we're seeing firsthand the consequences of a second-rate reality TV host who couldn't manage to stop committing crimes long enough to not get himself impeached, now embroiling us in a war that Congress didn't approve and the American people don't want.